Changing love is mountain for me. Hallelujah. Today's verses are all about communion, and they come from Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 to 26. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same breath, he took the cup after supper, and he said, "This is the cup, the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Amen. Dear Lord, we thank you that we can meet here today, a day on which we celebrate your communion, your Last Supper, a day in which you bless the meal and said you wouldn't drink it until you meet us again. Lord, we just ask that you bless our time this morning in the service. Bless all those ones that are here today and those that can't make it. Lord, we just thank you that we can come here freely in your name. Amen. Right, there you can go and say hello to everyone. Shake some tea.
They sinned against the Lord, and he sent snakes representing, and then the snakes bit them, there was a bit of people who sinned. And when, after they sinned, God still made a way out, which is very much like how a picture of today, that Jesus also mentions in John chapter 3 about Nicodemus, when he tells him that the Son of Man will be lifted up like the bronze serpent on the pole that Moses lifted up. And even till today, that picture, the bronze serpent on the pole, a lot of the medical world actually has that as a symbol. Very, very unique, right? And God was able to heal those people who, even though they were bitten by the snake, so they had sin in their lives, but they looked at the cross, that they looked at the bronze serpent on the pole, and all they needed to do was believe that God would heal them, and God healed them. But those who didn't look towards the cross, they died. Very much a picture of how today we all believe in Christ who died for us and rose again, amen? So let's all stand up and sing this song, Great is the Lord.
Great is the Lord, He is holy and just. Exceeding faith, above the things far above.
earth is full of your goodness, the earth is full of your love. Lord, we bring our tithes and offerings to you, our token to give to you. And Lord, we ask that you bless this money and you use it to further your kingdom, both in Otahu, New Zealand, and around the world. Lord, we do this because we love you. In your name. Amen.
There was another story as we go to this communion table. Let's remember another story. The first one, not a story, but it happened. The second one also happened. The first one was to forgive them of their sins. And the second one was when they went to the bitter waters of Mara. And that's the very first time that the Bible mentions the word healing. In Exodus chapter 15, the bitter waters were turned sweet when God asked Moses to take a piece of wood and drop it into the waters. It removed the bitterness from the waters so the Israelites could drink of it. And the Lord said in verse 26, I am the God that healed thee. This morning, there may be many of us here who are looking to the cross, looking to Jesus for healing. Let's remind ourselves of when God told the Israelites, I am the God that healed thee. This is what the Lord said to them.
I am the God that healed thee. I am Lord, your healer. I sent my word and healed your disease. I am the Lord, your healer. Thank you.
everything that you did on that cross, Lord. We can either choose not to avail of it, like some of the Israelites that didn't look up to the bronze serpent, or we can choose to look at it. I also want to pray for everyone this morning that's still not ready for the Lord's Supper, especially the youngsters. Lord, you strengthen them, Lord. You speak to them through the Holy Spirit. Because you want them in your kingdom. You want them redeemed. Because you want to speak to them and use them to go out to the world, to those people who are not coming up at the cross, who don't know about the cross, and who don't know about your power of forgiveness and healing, everything that you did. We thank you, Lord, as we go to your table, Lord, today, that we'll remind ourselves what a sweet, what a beautiful ordinance that you brought forth. You broke the bread and you drank the cup that was meant for us, so that we could be set free. And today we could celebrate your body and your blood. We thank you and praise you, Lord, for you alone are the center and the head of the church. In Jesus' most loving name. Amen.
Thank you very much to our worship team this morning. It's wonderful to see you on this first Sunday of, gee, what month are we in now?
December.
I think we, I think we missed January.
February.
Oh, it's February. Excellent. Next time I need to check my schedule, I'll be coming to you, all right? Daniel, all right, you know the time, date, now, that's great. Exactly what we need. Very shortly, the kids will go out and have a little bit of time. They'll be with us to observe the community service, right? That's wonderful. And a couple of things that I really need to mention just before we do settle into the time of the Lord's table. As a church, you know, we are putting together a bit of a flood relief and support. So over the next week or so, if you wouldn't mind, if you haven't done so already, if we could get together a bit of food, non-perishables, anything to do with nappies or toiletries of any description, you know, what's in the bathroom at home, nappies for babies, if you've got a spare blanket or sheets and things like that, you want to just support, and we'll bring those goods to charity out towards, I think it's over in Mount Eden actually, and they actually the Sandringham area of Auckland, Mount Roskill, all those locations that are quite close to Mount Eden, they got severely hit as well. So even those locations, not just Henderson or Rānui or Swanson in the far west of Auckland. So there's also quite a number of Baptist churches. Now as OCBC, we are under a mighty cloud of God's grace, of what he's actually given to us as a church. We have a lot of things, believe it or not. Although this is very old, and we're going nearly 100 years in this building, and some of you look like it as well. this is a cheeky little bit. Some of us are getting there. But as a means of resources, it's only fitting that we help some of the Baptist churches that are really being hit. Our national director, Charles Hewitt, he went and visited some of these churches, and it wasn't just the sight that shocked him, it was the smell. It's inside the churches, the damage. And some of you I know, Reinhardt, your little business workshop property that got flooded, and you can imagine, you can appreciate, you know, imagine if this auditorium, even bigger, you know, got severely damaged by water, and just, you know, things that are in the water, you know, it's not just rainwater, that's nice and clean, but, you know, once it gets contaminated and it's gone through a church building or the recreation center or the prayer room, you know, it's pretty horrible. So as a church, we're going to get some funds together, we're going to take some money out of the church account. If you want to give anything special towards that, you're most welcome to, of course. God puts that on your heart to do so, but nevertheless, we will be contributing to the Baptist Relief Fund to help some of our other churches. Also wanted to, just before I forget, because I will forget, the other day was Ignatius' birthday, so after the service, maybe we had a little bit of lunch afterwards, we have a bit of fellowship, so there's some nice flowers that are very beautiful, very fitting for communion service, being white and beautiful roses, lovely purity, things like that. Okay, there's some of the important announcements. There's other important dates coming up in February. I'll put that out onto the text messages. So if you have any questions about that, do feel free to ask me after the service. Let's come to the table and to God's word first of all. And I did have it here, here it is. I wanted to just do a short reading in two parts to the Corinthian church. The Apostle Paul highlights or gives a certain amount of emphasis in regards to the Passover and also to the communion table, the Lord's Supper, and how to go about that. If you know anything about the Corinthian church, they had a lot of issues. I mean, they had issues to burn. Such, and Paul, you know, we have two epistles in the Bible written to this church, not just one. They needed two, but actually there's a third also that hadn't been included in Scripture. So Paul had given this church, which is in Greece, it's in Corinth, they needed a lot of input, a lot of spiritual input, and there are a lot of issues. And so he says these words, and this is in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, you're welcome just to listen. And he says to this church, he says, your boasting is not good. Your boasting is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Little bit of the yeast that goes into the flour makes a dough to make the bread rise, to puff up. The leaven goes into the lump. And it only takes a very little bit, and it spreads and affects the whole lump of dough right before it is all baked. And then he says, cleanse out the old leaven. Cleanse it out. Wash it out. That you may be a new lump, as it were, a new lump of dough and bread mix, without the old leaven. The old leaven. Hence at Passover they had unleavened bread, right? That you may be a new lump as you really are. You really are unleavened, he says to the church. You are unleavened. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Let us therefore celebrate the festival. Let us celebrate the festival, not with the old leaven that puffs up, which is a symbol of sin, not with that old stuff, the leaven of malice and evil, but the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. The unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. That's how Paul says to celebrate the festival, as it is the remembrance of Christ as our Passover lamb. That was the first part. Then, of course, he goes on to further say in chapter 11, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread," it was unleavened bread, "and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" It's all centered on Christ. The whole thing about this, what we are doing at the table, it's all in remembrance of him. "In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes," until the return of Christ. So this has very great significance in remembrance and also looking forward to the return of Christ. And we do this to proclaim it until he comes. Let's pray for a moment. Let's just close our eyes and let's bring our hearts before the Lord. Is there any things that are unleavened within our hearts this morning that we want to confess, that we just want to be honest before God? Is there anything we want to ask God for forgiveness for? We need to do this as we prepare so we can celebrate festival. We can celebrate this feast, not with the old living, not the old one of dough and bread, but of the new. For we are unleavened in Christ because the Passover lamb has been sacrificed for us. That's a wonderful, great work of God, and only he could possibly do it. So just take a moment now just to pray or to give thanks. Any of those things that come to mind that the Lord lays on your heart, a reflection of his word before we come to the table. Yes, Lord, we thank you that you are indeed the Passover lamb who was sacrificed and yet now is risen and lives forevermore in the newness of life and the power of the resurrection. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, that your life took away our death sentence of eternity and separation from you has been dealt with because of the life of Christ. And Lord, we look to the cross, and even as we're reminded this morning, as the Israelites looked upon the brazen serpent on the pole, and indeed our life is healed because of Jesus Christ. That the death sentence, the sting of death has no more victory because of the greatness of the power of Christ when he took away our sins. And as far as the east is from the west, you have made the perfect provision for us to have our standing in his righteousness before you this morning and forevermore. But Lord, we know sometimes in our frailty, Lord, we make mistakes. We have slip-ups. We fall short of your glory. But Lord, we thank you, Lord, that it's your preserving love and your eternal mercy that sustains us when we cannot even sustain ourselves. So Lord, we do this in remembrance of what the Lord has done, and we celebrate this wonderful, simple feast of unleavened bread and the fruit of the vine and its juice. And Lord, this is enough that you have asked us to do. How could we forget? We have sometimes such short memories. But Lord, today, we thank you we can do this on the first Sunday of the month, to put you first, to acknowledge your wondrous work on the cross that you've done for us. For without you, we die. Without you, we cannot know what true life is all about. Without you, we cannot be healed. So Lord, we do all these things for your glory and for your name's sake. Until you come, we proclaim it. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Just ask Arnold and Barrett if you can meet me down the table and this appear to be served. Given to us, Lord, you on this time, our Lord has taken, Lord. Thank you that, Lord, he laid down his soul. He didn't die, but he died for our sins, Lord. And Lord, thank you so much that, please, Lord, you can remember what suffered and what he had done, Lord, and pressing on his side, Lord, and the blood went through, Lord. And thank you that through the blood, there's a remission of our sins. We are thankful and we believe it, Lord, for the salvation that is in this name. And Lord, as we protect this, the fruit of the vine, Lord, we just pray in the body. Pray that you will continue to bless us, help us, Lord, to always remember that only there was something, what they have done for us. Thank you for the perfect plan that you have given to all mankind, and especially those that you put in your church. In this way, we pray. Amen.
As we serve, as we do, hold on to the emblems and we'll eat and drink together. If you don't wish to partake this morning, that's all right. Just allow the emblems to pass you by. That's something between you and the Lord, and that's quite okay. The children, parents, so it's your own discretion, as you know, the children have not yet received Christ. Please don't need your time to come. Receive the Lord Jesus Christ, even today. And we'll be sitting at the table, so for me. Okay. shows that until he comes, there's something there to be done. Okay, so this morning's sermon, a little bit of time that we've got left. Don't forget, also today is our National Day, it is Waitangi weekend, important part of New Zealand's history. So I do believe we're going to do our best to sing the national anthem at the end of the service. It's the greatest national anthem in the world, that's my opinion, and many of you would agree with that for obvious reasons. It's a godly hymn. He acknowledges God, and you think that our nation was built on the foundation of God. In fact, many Western countries essentially in some ways were, but mind how times have changed. Mind how things have moved away from the foundations. But we stand on the foundation of Christ, thankfully, and we will keep standing, we will still remain firm, until the end. We will do so by God's grace. This morning I'm going to talk about the love link. The love link. It was wonderful in our opening song. We talked about the amazing love. What does the amazing love make you do according to the song? It makes you sing. It makes you sing. And actually the amazing love makes you do much more than that. We'll touch on a few of those things that are related to because of the love of Christ. I'll let Kerry put those things away. And then, good job. Kerry's a great servant of the Lord who loves to serve in the church. We thank you, Kerry, especially in regards to things like our food donations and things like that. Reading from Romans chapter 5, 6 to 11. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows His love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by His blood, that's the result of salvation in this first instance, we are justified, declared not guilty, by His blood. Much more shall we be saved by Him from the wrath of God, the wrath of God. Full outpouring of God's anger and judgment. We are saved from that. So it's going to be a key part and forms the heart of this morning's message. We are saved from the wrath of God.
For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God. We rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Our relationship to God has been reconciled, our sins have been dealt with, righteousness has been restored, imputed unto us, and we are reconciled back to God. Let's pray. Father God, indeed we thank you for your ministry of reconciliation, that while we were still weak in our sins, Christ died for the ungodly. Lord, I expect if there is only one person to die for in this world, you would have done it. If there are 5 or 10, you would have done it. Thank you, you did it for us. We thank you that you made the way possible, that we can be reconciled to you, to know you, to love you forever. We thank you, Lord, that the measure of our salvation, we can't measure it, we can hardly quantify it. But one day we will see the full results of it, when we are saved from the wrath to come, when we enjoy the pleasures of heaven for forevermore, we serve you in your kingdom to come. Lord, we look forward to those things. But until that time, Lord, we need your strength, we need your grace. Thank you, Lord, for your wonderful, abounding mercy upon our lives. We need your help and we need your healing. We need your feeding and we need your resting. Lord, we are such a dependent people. We are indeed children, living, as it were, under the provisions of the Father. Lord, we thank you. That is you. And now, Lord, bless us with your word. Feed us and nourish us with some great godly thoughts to sustain us and keep us going for this day and for the week ahead, even as we add more and more of the sustenance of your word into our lives. Lord, may our most holy faith build, grow stronger. And Lord, we will do great and more greater exploits for you in this world while we still have the time to do so, while we still are under this time of grace before your wrath really comes. So Lord, we thank you again for our service this morning in remembrance of the Lord Jesus. So now we look to the ministry of the Holy Spirit to enlighten the word to us, to enable us to hear and to be able to see great and wonderful things, Lord, that we need only you to reveal to us individually, personally, and us corporately as a church. Speak to us in the things, Lord, that you want us to hear this morning. For we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you remember in the last couple of weeks, our main theme is when we were obviously looking into this aspect or concept about abundance, the abundance in God. And there was another wonderful song that we sung just a few minutes ago, exceedingly, abundantly, da 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 da. Today we will kind of wrap it up, we'll leave that here today, that kind of thinking, with this concept, bring up there, Peter. It's the idea of more. Often when we think about abundance or we think about the word more, we think of quantity. I have more of this, or I have more of that. We put it into numbers. But when we talk about more or abundance, we can also be talking about more quality. It doesn't have to be quantity, it could also be quality. There could be an increase. There can also be a more increase of experience or knowledge or things like that. So there's three things with short message today which we will look at here from this passage when there is more. When God's love has been poured. When God's love has been poured. When we were enemies of God. And when the wrath of God arrives, when the wrath of God arrives, the verse before this wonderful paragraph in our text today brings in the aspect of God's love to it all. And this is why it's framed as the love link. The love link. God's love links all these things together. It's his love that eternally binds us to Christ, like a link in the chain. A chain which is unbreakable, which declares that our salvation is not only abundant, but is also full of assurance. Full assurance, like an unbreakable chain. And love is one of the links in the chain. It's a very important link that binds us eternally to the Lord. Beautiful verse just prior to our text really introduces this. So it was in verse 5 of Romans 5. It says, "And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts." God's love has been poured into. It hasn't been trickled into our hearts. It hasn't been drip-fed into our hearts. It is said to have been poured. It's been lavishly poured, abundantly poured into our hearts. And how did that happen? Well, the word of truth tells us it's been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. Holy Spirit is the great agent of application. The application of truth to our lives comes through the Holy Spirit. It's as if it were that the blood of Christ is still wet at the cross. It is still fresh. So any person 100 years ago, or 1,000 years ago, or God willing, many, many years from now, could still go to the cross, because of the application work of the Holy Spirit is still active and is still working. And so we can talk in past tense that one Christ died for the ungodly. While we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. It's spoken of in past tense, but it has perfect application for every future tense. Why even greater, even present tense? Maybe even today, in the present. Maybe there's someone here this morning, presently sitting here in this place before the things of God, hearing the things of God, and you're not sure of your salvation. The very work and application of Christ still available to you today, even though it may have been the best part of 2,000 years ago. It is still available. While we were still weak, Christ died for the ungodly. He died for you, as an effect that would be still effective today and forevermore, because it was the right time that Christ died. And so, the love is, in this sense, is the link. And God's love is being poured in. And this is the point. It is not our love that's been spoken of here. It's not our love for God that's been referenced here. It is the love of God. Not my love, not human love, but divine love. And this is an important starting place. You cannot love God properly, truly, effectively in your life. It has to be, the love of God has to have been poured into your heart and to my heart. And it's with that love, and on the basis of that love alone, that we can love God as he deserves. His love, his quality, his that abundance, it had to be poured. And so when this happens at the time of salvation, the heart is the recipient of the working agent of the Holy Spirit. This heart can no longer be the same. It has been infected. It has been affected. It has been given the effect
of God's love. There's God's love that is dwelling within the saved person. And with that now, we can love the Lord God in spirit and in truth as he commands. Without that, you cannot love God. You think you can. People think you can love God. They can set up all their shrines, they can set up all their fancy things and put things up on the walls and in a sense they think they can love God through those things. But here's the thing, God is spirit. And so them that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. In other words, it must come from the spirit that's within the person. Because that is the reality equal to the nature of God, who is also spirit. And this was a great conundrum, as it was, for the Israelites. When they declared, you know, some worship from Samaria, and some worship in Jerusalem, and some go to the synagogue, and some of this. And God, Jesus Christ said, enough of all that. Now on, you will love me, and you will know me through the working power of the Holy Spirit. Them that come to me by faith, them that come and have looked upon that brazen serpent in the wilderness and have been healed. See, the first thing that needs to be healed is the heart. Because without this heart, if it's not healed, it cannot love. And hurting people always hurt other people. It's a principle of life. The heart must be healed. And this is why it's the love of God that must be poured in to this broken heart, to this non-working heart. And with that then, now we can effectively love God as he desires. But without God's love, we cannot simply love God. It cannot be human love to make a relationship work with God. It just won't do. It must be divine, godly love that will eternally sustain our relationship with them and to them forever and ever. I ask you a simple question this morning. Do you have the love link? The love of God that links you to him? Or is your chain broken? Does it need to be fixed? Do you need to go to the metal man, as it were, and get that chain repaired? You must have the love link, because that is an important link that binds us to Christ forever. It is a love that never diminishes. It's a love that never goes cold. It's a love that is never based on circumstances. It is a divine, eternal love forever and ever. For me, my friends, that's almost something that's hard to get my head around, trying to work with a finite mind. But this is the truth. This is the spiritual reality. This is what God has made known. It is a love that will eternally sustain our relationship with him forever and ever. Unbreakable salvation fully guaranteed in the love link of Christ and to Christ. Unbreakable, always binding us to him. And so with that in mind, when God's love has been poured, the human heart can never be the same again. It will always be in the state and understanding and the very essence of the love of God. And so it is not our ability then that we can boast about to love God and to live for God. We can't boast in our own ability. It had to be poured into us in the first place, right? It was God who put it within us that makes it possible and acceptable. It is poured. It is a lavish work. It is an abundant work. If God loved us, then in verse part two here, when we were enemies with God, the verse says, while we were enemies, God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died We're justified by his grace, for if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by his death of his Son, much more now than we were reconciled shall we be saved by his life. If God so loved us in this way, and that while we were enemies to God, when you and I were fighting against God, against his will, against the very belief of his existence and who he is, against his commandments, when we're fighting against his commandments, we were enemies. And if God's love was working through Christ, that he died for us when we were in the state of his enemies, fighting against them, and God demonstrated his love. The point of these verses is, how much more now that we are the children of God, does he love us? The first part is superseded by the second part. We were loved by God when we were enemies. Much more now, much more abundantly now, we love now that we have been reconciled to him, and we are his people. We are the children of God. I just wanted to make something known to you. If you look at the verses again, Peter, if you bring up there our text, when we're thinking about the abundance, in those verses there, we have this term, much more. And it's in fact that the word more is mentioned three times. Three times, and this is a defined paragraph within Scripture. It is a section within itself because of the context, because of the subject matter. And within that paragraph, you'll find more mentioned three times. It is even overemphasized with much more on two occasions, right? Much more. So now, in times past, if God loved us when we were enemies, how much more? How do you quantify that? How do you put a number on that? A value? How much more does he love us now that we are reconciled to him? That we've been saved, that we have become one of his children, one of his people. And then how much more does God love this church? The body of his Son, the body of Christ. Yes, dearly will one die for a righteous man. Who would lay down their life? Because God had eternally loved the church. He had loved his people. He had loved his body. He was willing to do this. The very things that we celebrated and brought to remembrance this morning. I tell you what, though. Knowing now the love that we have in God, how much more have we experienced since the days of our salvation? You remember the day. Maybe it was the night, or maybe it was the morning when you believed and you opened up your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ for the first time and said, Lord, forgive me, a sinner. I accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I repent. I turn from my ways, your my sin, and I turn to Christ. Please forgive me and save me. The moment that you did that, how much more now, many years later, how much more have you experienced the things of God since that time? Who would have known? How would you have known? How would I have known how much more there was to have of the things of God since that time? Put your hand up this morning if you've experienced more of the things of God since becoming saved. Time passed, the things of God. Amen, of course we have. We've experienced much more of the grace of God. Gosh, I know I've experienced more of the forgiveness of God the times that I've stuffed it up. I've experienced the mercy of God. I can even say with the things that Michelle was bringing out this morning, how much more have I experienced the healing of God? Many times over, I've been healed many times not physically necessarily, but lots of other things need to be touched by God and to be dealt with and healed in life many, many times since the day. So much more since then. That's in a sense, one of the heart of this going on in this passage. How much more then, since the times that we were enemies and Christ had died for us, how much more now that we know the love of God? I really hope that since the time of your salvation, you know the love of God much more. Even as great as it was at the time that we got saved and we accepted Jesus Christ, that was fantastic. But how much more now that even time, it's not only that God loved me and saved me on that particular night, as it was for me. He's been loving me and keeping me saved for the last 20 something odd years, 30 years. How much greatness is the love of God that I appreciate and I know about since way back then. So when we were enemies, we are reconciled. And we are made the children of God. But then when we think up the next point, when the wrath of God arrives. In all these things, this paragraph is characterized by more, much, much more. And there are lots of things that are more that's going on in this wonderful truth. I really hope this morning that you'll walk away from here appreciating and realizing how much more there is of God. And hey, even from where we are at this point, there is still much more of the things of God to be had and to know and to be in the things to our realization anyway. And for that to happen, we've always got to have more appetite for the things of God, for the things of the Holy Spirit. If there's things going on in our life that are upsetting our spiritual appetite, that we don't have quite the hunger or the thirst or the desire for the things, I really urge you to deal with that. That's something that needs healing. You know, a baby, a child, doesn't have to be a baby, it could be a child, it could be 8, 9, 10. If they don't have a healthy appetite, what happens to them as time goes on? It's not so good, is it? Yeah, that's right. It's not going to go so well for them as they're going on at a time. Hey, if they, with that appetite that they do have, if they don't eat good, wholesome, nutritious food, what's going to happen? You can eat and eat and eat, but if the food's not good, what's going to happen to our health? Not going to go so well, is it? So spiritually speaking, the same principle applies. Have the hunger, but also feast and feed on the good quality, wholesome things of God, of which there are, or is, I should say, there is an abundance of it. We don't have to be in a famine in the things of God. But sadly, as I look around so often, in the body of Christ, it seems like the church so often is going through a crisis of a famine, where people aren't growing, the opposite is happening. Now, what's the opposite of growth? Shrinking, you might say. But to be perfectly honest and open, I know that in my own life sometimes as well, and I've got to pull myself up. I've got to address these things personally as well. Here comes the much more. Once again, much more of the grace of God. Where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. When we were enemies of the things of God and of God Himself, grace did much more abound. Live in that grace. Know the things of grace. Because when we step now into part three, the very wrath of God. The very wrath of God is evidenced in our text. Having been saved, since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, the point of salvation, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. It's a wonderful thing to be able to rejoice and to know from salvation, hey, I'm going to heaven. Or hey, I know my sins have been forgiven. Or hey, the love of God, I have the peace of God working in my life, and my relationship with God is restored, and I know the fullness, I know the meaning of life now, I have purpose in my life now. All those things are great. But often we don't think about much more than that. We have actually been saved from the wrath of God. The very wrath is judgment. We can be celebrating and having our festivals and the lights and the music and everything about the, jumping up for joy about the things of heaven. And yes, we might. We have right to do that. But to realize we have been saved from God's wrath. That takes something else to behold and to think about. Bring up the next screen there, because there's much more. Now, I quickly got to wrap this up. Read this along with me. The great day of the Lord is near. Near and hastening slowly. Now it says fast. Hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The sound is bitter. Normally things taste bitter, but the very sound of the day of the Lord is said here to be bitter. Not nice, right? The mighty man cries aloud there. A day of wrath is that day. A day of distress and anguish. A day of ruin and devastation. A day of darkness and gloom. A day of clouds and thick darkness. A day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. God says, I will bring distress on mankind so that they shall walk like blind. In other words, they will be looking for a way to escape, but they won't find it. They can't see a way out. There's no escape. Because they have sinned against the Lord, their blood shall be poured out like dust, their flesh like dung. Neither their silver nor their gold shall be able to deliver them, even if they have it in abundance, is what it's referring here. Them on the day of the wrath of the Lord, in the fire of his jealousy, all the earth shall be consumed for a full and sudden end. He will make all the inhabitants of the earth. An end, he will make all the inhabitants of the earth. I mean, when you look at this and you hear this, I mean, it looks like a scene or a screenshot for a movie, right? A day of darkness. Picture in your mind darkness, a day of darkness and gloom, and clouds are gathering. It's thick darkness, and there's a trumpet blast, and there's a battle cry. I mean, this is great material for Hollywood. Somebody call up Tom Cruise and make up a marvelous movie that would draw in millions of dollars. This is fascinating. This would draw crowds. But it's going to draw crowds for all the wrong reasons. Because people are going to find themselves under the wrath of God. Guess where this is from? I deliberately didn't put the reference up there. Where's that from? Where do you find it? Well, the first time you say it's in the Bible. Yeah, absolutely, you're right. But where in the Bible would you find this? You find it in Zephaniah. You find it in Zephaniah. He's such an insignificant prophet. He's only got 3 chapters in all of Scripture. He is so obscure, and yet he makes things so obvious. And such a small passage that's been allotted to him. His ministry was going on in the days of Jeremiah. And he was talking about the great day of the Lord is near. And that was centuries before Christ. And we've had 2,000 years since him. And God says it's near. And it's hastening fast. Not according to my calculations. Not according to your calculations or your calendar. But the things of God where one day is about 1,000 years. And 1,000 years is one day for the Lord. What is the matter of time with God when he's in eternity? When he says it's coming near to the things of God, it is near.
I mean, think about it, the days of Noah, when Noah was told that the wrath of God, the judgment was coming, and flood was coming upon the earth, and God was going to clean and wipe out the whole earth. God gave them plenty of time. He gave them 120 years to prepare. And still, the population didn't do anything. Still, they were unprepared. You see, it doesn't matter how much time God gives, even if it was one day or whether it was a million days. Most people, it still doesn't matter. God gives Noah and his family and the population of those days 120 years. Gosh, I think in our day and age, we would be asking, Lord, could you make it 150? We're going to take a little bit longer. As if 120 wasn't enough. We've had over 2,000 years. Hey, Zephaniah was writing the centuries before Christ. Maybe, you know, 400 years before Christ. See, here's the great thing about God's wrath and his judgment. He always makes it known to his enemies what he's going to do. He's given the plan. What army gives over their plans and their purposes to the enemy and say, this is what we're going to be doing. This is our plan. Who does that? No. But God does. Because this is the loving we're talking about. It's very earnest for the whole world, for God so loved the world. He would even tell the world what he's going to do. The very wrath of God can be avoided. Not saying that anybody can never say God is a mean God and thinks that it's going to happen. No, it's out of his love and his mercy that he's telling the world in advance, 2,000 years plus, much more, what he's going to do. He's made it all known, even through an insignificant prophet like Zephaniah, who says the great day of the Lord is near. Sometimes you may hear that God's judgment is already falling upon nations. Something may happen in the US. Maybe San Francisco has a terrible earthquake. Often I've heard many times, I've been in the groups of people, oh, that's God's judgment. America's experiencing God's judgment. Or hey, Auckland experiences a devastating flood. Or hey, New Zealand's experiencing God's judgment and wrath. I tell you, it's not even close. Because when God's wrath and when God's judgment, when it's really in action, God has already told us, he's already said what it's going to be like in advance. Because the escalation of calamity, the escalation of distress and devastation is so great, God in his love has to tell people that it's going to happen. It's not written in God's word that San Francisco is going to get an earthquake. God doesn't say that in his word. He doesn't say that Auckland's going to get a flood and this is the judgment. He doesn't say that. Because those things are minuscule compared to the things of the wrath of God. And the Bible says, our text to say, we have been saved from the wrath of God. We have been saved from the wrath to come. The things that are so dramatic and drastic and devastating. God's link, lovely, so marvelous and so wondrous that his warnings about these things comes with much time in advance so that people can repent. Nobody will stand an excuse. We finished the last slide here. So what happens on the day of wrath? The things that Zephaniah, what happens to the people, the beloved of God? The Bible says from Thessalonians in chapter 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, for God has not destined us for wrath, He has not destined us for wrath. And other versions will say, he has not appointed us to wrath. Either way, it works just fine. My goodness, you and I, we've been saved by the skin of our teeth. Judgment must first fall in the house of God. And if the righteous scarcely be saved, what happens to those that are outside the graces of God? We have not been destined for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. So in light of this truth, being not destined to the wrath of God, then if you were just to take a little bit of time, and we will perhaps in coming weeks, look into the wrath of God in a deeper sense, I'm sure of this, you will see the love of God in such a more greater, powerful light than perhaps you've ever seen before. More so, even, much more so, than from the day of your salvation, looking ahead through the love light of the love link of Christ's revelation of what is yet to come. We are no longer the children of wrath. We are no longer under his judgment, but the children of God's love. We have been adopted into the family of God by the precious payment made by Jesus and the giving up of his life for us. This is certain, but so is the day of God's wrath. That is equally as certain as our salvation. If you have been saved from the things of God, these tremendous, dramatic, and distressing and devastating things of God, if you haven't been saved, if your future hasn't been secure, if you don't know these words that we have not been destined to the wrath of God, before you leave this place today, you need to make sure that you know these things and you're right with God. Because the love link is only effective as long as this door of the covenant is open to enter into the things of Christ. But there comes a day when the door will be shut, and that will be it, and it will be all over, and your future will be sealed outside of the things of God. So, make sure you know that precious payment today. In God's great love, we have been delivered from sin, and we have been delivered from the wrath to come. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for your graciousness again. Thank you, Lord, for the things that you revealed for us in your word. You've told the people, you told the world so many years in advance of warnings. I pray, even as we see these examples of calamities happening in the world through nature, Lord, I pray that it would make people realize more and more just how much they need you and to turn to you for salvation. Thank you, Lord, for saving us from your wrath to come. We have not been destined to be in that, but we are safe in the hands of Jesus. We thank you in Jesus' name. Okay, now, Arnold, would you come up and this will stand up, just will stand up for a moment.
You want me to sing down the astronaut?
I'd like you to sing the solo.
A little bit.
Why don't we sing the national anthem first?
We initially planned to have a song and everyone sing to it. Turns out we weren't able to find one, so we'll play and we'll all sing together.
Because we've got the words up there.
Thank you.
is gone, and we still want to do a few other things, and we'll catch up with other things next week. And perhaps, Ryan, could you close us in prayer in a moment? That would be great. Thank you, brother. These wonderful words of the doxology from the simple epistle of Jude, it's so rich and profound. To the only God, our Saviour, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority, before all time, and now forever. Amen. Let's pray.
Father, we thank you for your abundant love. We thank you, Father, that while we were still enemies, you loved us.
Yes.
You gave your Son for our lives. Father, we can't thank you enough. We praise your name. We glorify you. And we pray that you be with us in the coming week, wherever we go. You protect us, guide us, and help us to make the right decisions. Be with us today. Bless the food we are to eat. Father, would you be in there and bless us. Pray your blessing over each single one of us. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Hey, stick around. We're going to have a little bit of a luncheon and fellowship. It'd be good to catch up with each other. And outside, we'll do a happy birthday for your blessing outside. That's it. Let's go.
Thank you. Yeah, that's gone. Every day too. The Chinese are moving out to overseas. You've got a lovely fresh commodity.
Joel, well done with this.
Well done.
We should dissolve.
Yeah, I have to move out.
Michelle.